Okay, welcome everybody. And today's speaker is Andrea Lucchini, and it's a great pleasure for me to introduce Andrea Lucchini, whom, of course, many of you already know. And today he will talk about applying the Kovári-Sostouran theorem to a question in group theory. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Martino. And since I assume that we are in friend, I try an experiment this evening because I give a talk on this subject for the very first time. And not only this first time that I give a talk on this argument, but preparing the talk, I realize of a result that I missed in the paper. So I will present a result for a very first time, something which never appeared. So the starting point is a question asked in 2001 by Bertrand Neumann. We have a finite group, and we assume that this finite group has the following property. There are two positive integers, say m and n, and the property is that however a set capital M with m element and another set capital N with n elements are chosen, at least one element in the first set commute with one element in the second. This is a condition, and the question asked by Neumann is not completely precise. He asked what relations between the order of G and these two number M and N guarantee that G is abelian. And the idea is that if you have this property and G is huge, then you have any element commuting. And so maybe the group is abelian. So this is the idea behind this question. And there was an answer given by a team of Iranian guys. And their answer is that there is a function f from the square of the positive integer to the positive integer with the following property. Take a finite group G with the previous property, however, set of m elements and the set of n elements are chosen, at least one element in the first set commute with one element in the second. If the order of G is larger than the function f computed in the pair n-m, then G is abelian. This is the result proved by the Iranian people. And if you look to the paper, they also give an estimation of this function because they prove that it is possible to take f to be this function c to the n plus n times the maximum between m and n, where this c is a constant appearing in an important theorem proved by Lassie-Pieber in 1987. The result by Pieber is that if a finite group G contains at most n pairwise non-commuting elements, then there is a bound for the index of the center. The index of the center is at most c to the n. If you believe in this theorem by Pieber, the proof of the theorem of the Iranian people is quite short. I say if you believe in the theorem of Pieber, not because the theorem is false, but because it is an important theorem with a complicated proof. And if you look to the proof, I think that there is no hope to deduce a good estimation for the constant C. At a certain point, Piper notices that this C taking the step of the proof is quite huge, something like 2 to the 30, something like that. So the paper by Piper is not very ambitious of giving a precise estimation of C. And one of the purpose of the talk, something that will be, we will see later, is that we are able to have an alternative proof of this result with a good estimation for this constant. Some remark about this theorem by the Iranian people. One remark is that you see that here we have something which is exponential in n plus n, and it is not possible to avoid that. Because if you take an extra special two group of order 2 to the 2k plus 1, then the maximal non-commuting sets have size 2k plus 1. It means that if you take subset of size 2k plus 2, then in this subset at least 2 elements commutes. And this is the reason why you cannot have something, for example, polynomial in M and N. Nevertheless, this is not important for the rest of the talk, but it's something that deserves to be mentioned. The function can be chosen to be polynomial in M and N under the additional assumption that the group G is insolvable. You see, here there is a statement, take an insolvable finite group with the usual property, however, set M and set N and so on before, then we have a bound, this time a better bound on the order of the G, it is at most 4 to the 4 times N plus N to the 8 times the maximum between M and N. And this is a full story about this question by Neumann. And this question stimulated a generalization, and due to this possible generalization, take again two integers, m and n, and let x be your favorite class of groups, of finite groups. And we say that a group G satisfies the condition x, m, n, if whenever you have two subsets, capital M and capital N of cardinalities, respectively M and N, there exists an element X in the first set and an element Y in the second, with the property that the subgroup generated by X and Y belongs to the class X. You see that if X is the class of abelian groups, this is precisely the situation in the question by Neumann, because asking that X and Y, the subgroup generated by X and Y, is abelian, is equivalent to asking that these two elements commute. And for the rest of the talk, we say that G belongs to X, M, N if the group G satisfies this condition. And in 2012, another Iranian guy, Zarin, proposed the following question. Let G be a finite group, and suppose that G is not in the class X. Thus, there exists a bound depending only on M and N for the size of G if G satisfies the condition X, M, N. If you substitute to X the class of abelian group, you are precisely in the situation that I described before. And in the same paper in which I asked for this question, Darren gave some affirmative answer. Indeed, he gave an affirmative answer for the class of Mirkett groups. And in an earlier paper, Bob Bryce gave a positive solution for the class of super solvable groups under the additional condition, but not too restrictive, that N and M coincide. I don't give the details of the result by Zarin and Bryce because they are bound. Are not nice. They have the bound, but they are very complicated function in terms of M and N. And one of the part of my talk is not only to give an alternative proof for the abelian case, but also an alternative proof and a generalization of these theorems by Zarin and Bryce. And in order to describe my approach to the problem, I need to introduce the theorem in the title. And before I need some basic, that we call some basic definition from graph theory. So remember that a bipartite graph is a graph in which the vertex set is split into subsets U and V, till joint subset, and the possible edges are only between elements of the first set and element of the second set. This is a bipartite graph, a complete bipartite graph. Is a bipartite graph in which every pair of a vertex from U and any vertex from V are connected to each other. So we have this disjoint subset U and V, and we have an edge in the graph between any possible element in the first and any possible element in the second. And just a notation, a complete bipartite graph in which the two parts U and V as cardinality respectively S and T is in general denoted with the symbol KST. And with this elementary terminology, the Zarankiewicz problem, what is it? It is an unsolved problem in mathematics and ask for the largest possible number of edges that you can have in a graph with a given number of vertices in such a way that this graph does not contain a bipartite subgraph of a given size. And this is a typical problem of extremal graph theory. And it was asked by this Polish mathematician Zarankiewicz in 1951. And after a few years, this guy, Kovari, Sos, and Turan, gave an upper bound for the solution of the Zarankiewicz problem. So this is the theorem in the title, and is the result that I'm going to apply. So we have two positive integers, and it is interesting to decide which is the smaller and which is the larger. So assume that M is smaller or equals than N. And we have a graph with T vertices, and if this graph has enough age, say in some sense, then it contains a copy of the complete bipartite graph K, M, N. And when I say enough age, it means that the number of age must be at least this complicated number, which depends on N, T, and M. I'm going to use this result in order to have a very short and efficient proof of the theorem that I proposed before. So maybe after my talk, you can suspect that this covariance of Turan is a deep result. But this is not the case. If you try to read the original paper, the language is difficult, it's not written using graph theory but Hodge symmetrics, so it appears to be quite complicated. But at the very end of my talk, if I have time, I will show you that this can be proved in 3 minutes with a double counting algorithm. So we can say that this is an elementary result in graph theory. And why this elementary result in graph theory is important for our purpose? Because of this theorem that I proved years ago. So we have a class of group, and we assume that there exists a real positive number gamma with the following property. Take a finite group X, consider the probability that two elements of X generate a subgroup which belong to our class. If this probability is at least our number gamma, then the group is in the class. And assume that we have M and N, with M smaller or equal than N, and assume that G is a group which belongs to the, which has the property XMN, the property that I mentioned before, but is not in the class. Then we have a bound for the order of the group. And we have an easy bound in some sense, because you see that the formula is easy, the order of G is at most 2 over 1 minus gamma to the N times N minus 1. It is an elementary result, so I can give the complete proof of this result. It's just a few line proof. So assume that we have a group with the property XMN, which is not in X. And we consider a graph. I give this name gamma X of G. It is a graph in which the vertices are the elements of G. And two vertices are joined by an edge if and only if the subgroup generated by these two elements is not in X. For example, if you are considering the class of abelian group, this is a graph that is known with the name of non-commutative graph. You have a graph in which the vertices are the group element, and we have an edge when two elements do not commute. And now we consider eta, the number of edges of the graph. And then we have two information about eta. We have the fact that G is not in the class X. And remember that the gamma has the meaning that if the probability that two elements generate a subgroup in X, then the group itself, if the probability is at least gamma, then the group itself is in the class. In this case, the group is assumed not to be in the class, and so it means that the probability that two vertices are joined by an edge in our graph is at least 1 minus gamma. And so it means that we have a lower bound for the number of edges. The number of edges is at least 1 minus gamma times the square of the order of G over 2. On the other hand, G is not in the class X. G is not the X, M, N property. Using our graph, this sentence can be translated in another sentence. This means that our graph cannot contain, as a subgraph, the complete bipartite graph K, M, N. And so we can use the covariance of Courant theorem, because we have that our graph does not contain the bipartite K, M, N graph as a subgraph. And so, according to the preview, the covariance of Courant theorem, we have now an upper bound for the number of the edge. And this is precisely the statement of the covariance of the Courant theorem, in which I replace T, the number of vertices of the graph, with the order of the group. And when you have this information, we are at the end of the proof, because combining 2 and 1, the right part of 2 is larger than the right part of 1. You divide both sides by t squared over 2. You have this inequality, and with some stupid algebraic manipulation, you obtain the result. So this is a general theorem. It works for any class. And so it's a move to the problem of finding, when it is possible, a number gamma with a requested property. What happened? So go back again to the class of the finite abelian group. In this case, there is a nice result by Gustafsson, an older result, 1973. If G is a finite non-abelian group, then the probability that a randomly chosen pair of elements of G commutes is at most 5 over 8. So if you combine the previous theorem, you may take instead of gamma 5 over 8, and we have this result. You have that the order of G is at most 16 over 3m times n minus 1. So this is my alternative formula with respect to the formula of the Iranian guys that I showed you before. Remember the formula that I showed you before was this one, c to the m plus n times the maximum between m and n. And I told you that the problem was that there was no good estimation for c. Now, in this new formula, instead of the sum of m plus n, we have only m. Here we have the maximum, so this is an improvement. But the nice fact is that instead of having a constant, which in Weber's paper is something like 2 to the 30, is a very small constant, 16 over 3. And this is not the only nice information. I told you that the proof of the Iranian guys depended on the deep result by Weber. Now, instead of using the deep result by Weber, we may use the result by Gustafsson. And the result by Gustafsson is completely elementary. It is a result that can be teach in a class of algebra or through second year class of algebra. Just remember how it works. So, a very elementary proof for this theorem. Remember that the probability that two elements of the group commute is precisely the ratio between the number of conjugate classes depth and the order of the group. And so we may play with the class equation. The order of G is equal, according to the class equation, to the sum of the order of the center plus the cardinality, the sum of the cardinalities of the non-trivial conjugate classes. Of course, immediately, these non-trivial conjugacy classes, all of them contains at least two elements, and so immediately we deduce that G minus order of G minus order of the center divides two is at least T, and then putting this information together with this, nothing more, we have that the number K of G, the number of conjugacy classes, is at most order of G plus order of the center over two. And then, since G is non-abelian, the quotient over the center is not cyclic. This means that the center is the order of the center is at most the order of the group over four. And so the answer is that, which is completely elementary. So you see that using this theorem, graph theory, we have a very elementary proof answer to the Neumann question. And now we may try to approach other class. So remember, the problem is for which class it is possible to have a positive number gamma with this property. And we are lucky because there is a deep result proved in 2000 by Guralnik and Wilson. It is a consequence of the classification of the finite simple group. And they prove the following. There exists a real number k, strictly between 0 and 1, with the following property. Take X to be any class of finite groups which is closed undertaking subgroups, quotient, and extension. And let G be a finite group if the probability that two randomly chosen elements of G generate a group is greater than K, then G belongs to the class. So in some sense, this theorem says that we have a result similar to the theorem of Gustafsson for any reasonable class, where reasonable in this case means close undertaking subgroup quotient and extension. Of course, having this result, now one would like to have a good estimation of this k. So let me say something about whether it is possible to have an estimation for k. There is a sentence in the paper by Guralnik and Wilson, which is not completely correct, but it is important, so I want to show you this sentence. They wrote, one may speculate that the number k can be taken to be 5 over 18, and the reason for this 5 over 18 is that it is the probability that two elements of the symmetric group of degree 3 generate a 3 prime group, a group of whose order not divisible by 3, and two elements of a finite simple group generate the group with probability at least 19 over 30. If you are familiar with some probability of generating a simple group, maybe you immediately realize that at least the second part of the sentence is false, because if you consider the probability of generating a simple group with two elements, then when we take the alternating group of degree 6, this probability is 53 over 90, which is smaller than 19 over 30. So at least the second part of the speculation is wrong, but this sentence is essentially correct. And so I have to explain better the meaning of this sentence. And in order to do that, I need to record something. Assume that G, I need a couple of definitions. If G is a normal sub, if G is a finite group with a normal subgroup N, and the factor group G over N can be generated by D elements, then we may consider the ratio between the probability of generating G with D element and the probability of generating G over N with the element. And that is, if you like, the language of probability theory, is the conditional probability of generating G by D randomly chosen elements, given that these elements project on the generating set for G over N. Behind that, there is an important remark by Gaussius. The remark by Gaussian is the following. Suppose that we have the element x1, xd generating g together with n. And suppose that the group g can be generated by the element, then this conditional probability is precisely the number of delta poles N1 and D in the D power of the normal subgroup with the property that X1, N1, XD and D generate the group over, of course, the cardinality of N to the D. And the important fact which makes possible to work with this definition is that this number is independent of the choice of X1 and D. We only require that this element has the property of generating G together with N. And the reason why I need this definition is the following. I need to recall other two results. Take F, a finite Hamiltonian simple group, and take two automorphism, alpha and beta of S, and denote by H the almost simple group generated by alpha, beta, and the inner automorphism of S. And here there are two results. Result that I proved several years ago in a joint work with Francesca Dalla Volta. No matter how you choose alpha, beta, and sigma, this number prob h, s computed in 2 is always positive. And this number tends to 1 when the order of the simple groups tends to infinity. With this information, you may deduce that there exists a positive real number delta with the property that the conditional probability respect with the almost simple group S alpha beta comma S computed in 2, this complicated story that I told you before. This number is always at least delta for any possible choice of S, of alpha, and beta. Of course, this is an immediate consequence of these two results. And why I'm interested in this delta? We go back to the paper of Guralnik and Wilson. And the empty is a result which is apparently complicated, but I will show you that we can use easily indeed this result. So take our class, which is closed undertaking subgroups, quotient, and extension. And now I have defined some number. First, it is delta x, which is a number with the probability, with the property that the conditional probability as before with alpha, beta, and s is at least delta x for all non-abelian simple group outside the class X and all the possible choice of alpha and beta. If you think a little bit, if for example X is the class of the five-bubble group, that all the non-abelian simple group are outside the class, so this delta X is precisely the delta that I described before. But this is not the end of the story, there is also this K star, and this depends which abelian simple group belong to the class. So K star is zero if the cyclic group of order Q is in X for any possible choice of Q. Otherwise, we have to look for the smallest prime such that the cyclic group of order Q is not in the class. And we have to take the minimum between 1 over Q and 5 over 18. Remember, 5 over 18 was the number that appeared in the sentence that I showed you before by Turani and Wilson. And then we have to take K to be the maximum of these two numbers. And then the theorem is that this K works as we hope. So suppose that the two elements of a finite group generate X with probability greater than K, then G is in the class. And so, as a corollary, we have that an immediate corollary of this previous theorem that in any case, we have a bound for K. K is at most the maximum between 1 minus delta and 5 over 18. This was the situation in 2000, the time in which Guranik and Wilson wrote their paper. There is an important new thing, and the new thing is that 7 years ago, in 2013, Nina Menezes, which is a PhD student of Kolbar et al., together with Kolbar and with Martin Pick, they compute the precise value of delta. Because the result is that if you take our two generated almost simple group, then the conditional probability in which we are interested is at least 53 over 19 with equality only for the alternating and symmetric group of degree 6. And so we can go back to this corollary. Instead of delta, we can put 53 over 19. And so we have that K is at most 43 over 19. And so now we have a general result. A general result is that let X be any class of finite group which is closed for subgroups, quotient group and extension. Let G be a finite group. And if M is smaller than N, and G has the property XMN, but is not in the class X, then we have an upper bound for the order of G. At most, the order of G is at most 180 over 53 to the M times N minus 1. And if you take the paper of Guranik and Wilson, there are some other interesting numbers. The constant K is precisely computed in some important flux. You see that it is 11 over 30 if you consider the solvable groups, 1 over 2 if you work with an impotent group, 1 over 4 if you consider group of odd order. And so this means that you can insert this number in the theorem that I proved before, and you have the variation of the result. So you see that we have a bound in the case of nilpotent group, in the case of solvable group, in the case of group of odd order. I told you before, for example, that Starin proved a result for nilpotent group, but this bound is more efficient and more readable with respect to the bound that you can find in the data paper. Oh, I have a few minutes to conclude. I'm not an expert in infinite group, but Bertrand Neumann was an expert in infinite group, and so certainly when he proposed the question, as I show you at the very beginning, he had also in mind the infinite group. But in this case, the question in the case of infinite group is trivial, because assume that we consider an infinite group with the property AMN. It means an infinite group with the property that there are these two M or N, with the property that whenever you take a subset with an element and another with an element, then one element in the first commute with one element in the second, then the group is certainly abelian. And the proof is easy, so I can show you. Assume that we have a group G with this property. And in particular, every infinite subset of this group contains two commuting elements, because it contains two subsets of cardinality. And that really. And here there is a famous theorem of Neumann, a group with this property centered by finite. So in particular, the center is infinite. And if you know that the center is infinite, you consider M and N, two subsets of the center of size M and N. If you like, there is no restriction in the choice. And then you can take two elements of the group, X and Y. And since the group satisfies the property A, M, N, we may consider the coset X capital M, Y capital N. And since we have the property, there is an element in the first coset commuting with an element of the second coset. But this means that the element in the first coset is, for example, X at 1. So X at 1 commute with Y at 2. But since that 1 and that 2 are elements of the center, then you may delete that 1 and that 2. And you remain with the information that X and Y commute. If you work in other class, the question is more difficult. For example, if you consider the class of nilpotent group, Zarin proved that in an infinite group, if an infinite group has the property NMN, the usual property with respect to the class of nilpotent group, then every two generated subgroup is nilpotent. But of course, this does not imply that the group is nilpotent, so you can walk in this direction. And just to conclude, I promise I made this sort of propaganda to the covariance of Turan theorem, showing that it can be used to prove deep result. So as I told before, maybe you suspect that it is a deep theorem. Indeed, it is an elementary theorem, and the proof is a three-line proof. And it is a double counting argument in which you count the star in our graph. Remember that a star denoted by f of k is a tree with one internal node and k bits. So we have a graph in which we have the center of the star, the internal node, and all the edge go to the k bits. And now suppose that the gamma is a graph that does not contain the bipartite, the complete bipartite graph K and T. And let N be the number of vertices and E the number of edge. And sigma be the number of stars of cardinality S in this graph. And we may count in two different ways, or better estimate the number of star in two different ways. One possibility is that we select the internal node and then we consider the leaves for the star. It means that we have this formula for the number of the star, a sum over all the vertices, and then we take the degree of the vertices and we consider the set of the neighborhood of the vertices, and we select the S lib of the star, because they must be S element adjacent to the given vertex. And then you use this estimation, which is indeed the only critical part of the proof, because it is in some sense a consequence of the Janssen's inequality for convex function, but after that all the other are standard computation, and so you have this lower bound for sigma over n. But you may also count the star from the point of the leaves. So first you select the possible S leaves of your star, N over S possibility. And then you count how many vertices could be the internal node of the star. And since you have not KST bipartite subgraph, for any possible set of S vertices, you have only T minus one possible node that can be the internal vertices that can be the internal node. And so you have this upper bound, and then the conclusion of the proof is just a matter of computation, because this number here is smaller than this number here. You compare and you do some silly manipulation and you obtain a bound of N of E in terms of M and D. And this is the end of the story, so thank you for your attention. Or if you like, there is some reference. Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you very much. And I would like to thank the speaker. Thank you very much for the very nice talk. And please, if someone has questions or comments, please, you can ask. So maybe I have a question, like, what about, I mean, because it was, I didn't, maybe you said about these fractions that appear in the result, like for different classes of groups, abelian, nilpotent.
No, in all the cases, they are best possible.
Ah, they are best possible in all the cases, okay.
In all the cases, they are best possible, yes. You mean that is 1131 over 2, 1 over 4.
Ah, yes, these one are okay. So the other ones are also best possible. These ones. No, no. Yes.
This
yes.
One. This one. I'm not sure.
Ah, okay.
I'm not sure, but I suspect that. You have the same problem just in the abelian case. Because in the abelian case, I told you that there is the constant produced using Gustafsson.
Uh-huh.
And I told you that the result is near to be best possible if you compare with the behavior of the extra special group.
Uh-huh.
But maybe it does not prove that 16 over 3 is best possible for this kind of theorem. Maybe okay. It could be, it must be at least 2, I think, according to the behavior of the extra special group. So there is no hope to reduce too much. But maybe, I don't think that it is best possible like that.
Okay. Are there any more questions? Okay. So in that case, I would like to thank the speaker again. And then maybe we can take a picture together. This is our tradition. Andrea, if you want to stop the sharing, we could take a picture together. Oh, okay, thanks. Okay, so, but it will just take some time, but if you want to, wait a second. I just need to visualize all the. View, okay. Gallery here. Oh, great, okay. Just a second. Okay, so. Okay, this is one. And hold on for just another second and then, okay, done. Thank you.